YouTube, thanks for tuning into the channel. Your boy Devin Coates, day 43, 48 days with the 48 laws. Let me jump right into it. Oh, you can also pick up a copy, link in the description below. So law 43, work on the hearts and minds of others. Judgment. Coercion creates a reaction that will eventually work against you. You must seduce others into wanting to move in your direction. A person you have seduced becomes your loyal pawn, and the way to seduce others is to operate on their individual psychologies and weaknesses. Soften up their resistance by working on their emotions, playing on what they hold dear and what they fear. Ignore the hearts and minds of others, and they will grow to hate you. So I read this a while ago because obviously I got my dad's mom. It's pretty hard to shoot stuff. So the first story was of Louis the 16th. So after Louis the 15th, I know he was in a previous law, so if you're following along, you probably are catching through. And he actually was like a terrible failure and kind of really sucked after coming after his either his dad or his brother, Louis the 14th, who was the Sun King, who was great. And so Louis the 16th came in and they were trying to kind of change everything. So when Louis the 16th comes in, he marries Marie Antoinette, and they actually loved her in the beginning. And that love actually developed into hate because all she really was worried about, like since she came there and didn't do anything, and they all really loved her energy, she kind of was like the spoiled brat, you know, the person that gets too much too early. And all she really was into was like building all this shit, like the garden. She built like a Garden of Eden palace and built all these extravagant things. Her hair was known, I guess, like making it higher was like a big thing of the time. So she used to build her hair very high, and she really was into spending a lot of money during that time. And everybody's probably heard of that whole let them eat cake thing. But basically, France was going through a famine at that time. She's like eating the most extravagant meals, throwing the biggest fetes, parties. And it's just all this extravagance is happening. And that whole let them eat cake thing was that everybody's grumbling about, you know, they're like, there's a revolution. It wasn't really in this, but I just remember hearing it through passing. In my regular life, but it was like, you know, they're talking about how they're starving, how you're throwing all these balls, spending all this money, and you really don't give a fuck about the people. And she's like, well, let's just let them eat cake then. But what really left her to her eventual demise is the fact that she really just wasn't thinking about the people. When people confronted her about it, she didn't really mince words in terms of like, you know, my bad. She didn't even really try to lie about it. She kind of just was one of those people that felt entitled, felt that she was right, and you weren't going to change that. And she kept throwing those balls and things, and around Versailles, they actually stormed Versailles. She had to move to Paris, and she just kept it up. She didn't stop, and eventually she was killed, and she was pretty much holding that same stance until the day she died. She never really changed, and she just thought that she was deserved everything for nothing, and just was completely cool with spending all of France's money on things that didn't matter when the civilization, people were dying. And I think that she actually was like the last one, and they kind of like ended the whole monarchy because of how terrible all that stuff happened. The second one, I really like this story. This is one of the stories that, rereading this, I haven't read the whole thing through in probably since I was around 20, 21. So that's about 4 to 5 years ago. But this story is one of the ones that always sticks out to me. So it's in China. It's sometime BC, but Zhu Guoliang, and basically he is in a predicament. He has an enemy to the north that he needs to worry about, and an enemy to the south that he needs to worry about. And he doesn't want to spend all, like he doesn't want, he needs to figure out how to solve this problem, because they're always going to be there, and he needs to at least remove one of the fronts, because you don't want to be getting attacked for two fronts and have to split your military at any point. So he has an advisor. His advisor basically tells him, don't try to basically through war coerce this guy. Try to work on work it out like through his heart or something of those. And Zhu Guoliang, yeah, actually, I was thinking that you read my mind, is exactly what I was thinking. So basically what happened is Meng Huo, that's the guy from the south, They have a weaker army, and Chulalongkorn can actually destroy them pretty easily. Mengua goes up and he attacks them. Liang basically sets up this elaborate setup where he captures a bunch of his troops. And this is the first one. He captures a bunch of his troops and then he brings them all in. They're all very nervous because obviously they're thinking they're about to be massacred. He gives them all this food, bribes them, and basically says, I'm sure that all of you guys have families, mothers, fathers, sons, kids to go back to that are chomping at the bit and worried about whether you're going to return or not. And I respect that. And I'm going to give you all of these riches. I think he probably took their weapons and he was like, go home to your families. I'm not going to kill you. Don't worry. Just go home. And he separated Mengua actually from everybody else. So all of these soldiers go home actually crying and tearing, and you have to imagine how emotional a situation must like that must be. You go to war, you think you get captured, you're thinking you're dying or getting tortured to death. So Mengua is captured, and then Chulalongkorn basically says to him, if I let you go, what will you do? He's like, I will gather another army and come back to fight you. So he leaves, he tries to gather his army, but so Army's a little bit hesitant, and basically over the course of the next couple of years, he attacks Chuko again, and then he gets captured again. He asks him the same question. He's like, and he always makes all these excuses. So it's like one time, well, you tricked my soldiers. You bribed them. You bought them off. Oh well, because this happened, and oh well, you got lucky. And it happens like six or seven, like around six times that they take. His soldiers are starting to basically get fed up. They're like, yo, this dude is actually, Chuko's actually pretty cool. He's a good guy. Every time we're coming to kill him and every time we get brought there, he basically spares our lives and sends us back to our kids and family. Like, fuck you. We're not trying to work for you anymore. Like, this dude is, we're outmatched, and he is actually kind enough to not kill us. So he actually had already worked on the hearts and minds of the soldiers. So Mengua actually goes down to another rival that's even further south in China, and he employs their help, and they come, and they're a very fierce warrior culture, and basically they have this this armor that is basically it's like, it sounded like the roots of trees, but then they put oil on it and then they let it harden, and it's just like basically like an impenetrable type of shield. So he attacks with this army who's another rival, and basically Chulalongkorn knows what's happening, sets an elaborate trap where they walk into this pit, and then he lights fire all around that army. He separates Mengua away. And since they're in oil armor, actually, like, it was almost like some, like, Final Fantasy type or Pokemon type shit. Like, he hit them with the weakness, you know. It's impenetrable to piercing attacks, but fire attacks, critical damage. So, burns them all up. They all die. Kills all of them. But he takes Mengua again. And basically, at this time, after the seventh time, he basically, like, breaks down. He's like, honestly, you... I can't beat you. You capture me every time. There's nothing I can do. And you have basically more mercy than I would ever have. You're like a gift of the gods. And we'll never do this again. You've got me. And actually what Chuko does, he doesn't like enslave his people or anything. He basically says, you just be the ruler of your land and just be, we'll just have an alliance. And basically for the rest of the reign, he had his alliance, he had a very loyal partner for the rest of his reign in his region. And he worked on his mind. Instead of trying to attack and then whenever he would forget about that empire that Mengua is running, instead of attacking them the first time and then trying to go to the north, and then having this re-emerging, you know, and you're just going to rebuild and try to attack again. There's always going to be this resistance. There's always going to be this revolt in this area. He had accomplished this in a way that had less bloodshed. And then also he had an alliance that was formed. So he actually had protection in the South now. Instead of having a liability, he moved it to an asset. Just a little side note, especially because we're talking about China, and it seems like a lot of people followed these kind of rules, and a lot of the stories in China, there's a certain eloquence. And Sun Tzu, he in the Art of War, he mentions that, like, something along the facts that it's like towards the end of the book, he gives all these strategies. He goes, actually, the best way to win a war is to not have a war. If you can do anything to avoid a war, that is a better strategy. Like, war is the last resort, because that is the bluntest form of gaining power. So working on the hearts and minds of others is very critical, very important. And there's no reversal to the law, and it's one of my favorite laws. It's not really one that I really feel like is the one I mess up the most, but it's the one that is very inclined to my character, and it's one of the ones that I think I can kind of double down on and use as a power base. Because I'm really into, like, psychology and studying people and trying to figure out what makes them tick and how I can serve that. And I mean, I'll be honest. I mean, a lot of it is for my own benefit, but that's something that's very intriguing to me. So that's it for this one. It's a little bit long. I have a few more left. I think it's five more. Thanks for tuning in. Like, comment, subscribe. Pick up your copy. Link in the description below. Till next time, peace.